Okay, well, it's a great pleasure to have Wolfgang Lück here, and this will be the first of his three talks, an introduction to L2-invariants.
Can you hear me? Yeah. First of all, thank you very much for the kind invitation. I have tried to keep these three lectures quite independent of one another as much as you can. And secondly, I've prepared many more slides than I will show. So you can't really guess from the number of slides how far I am in my talk. I will not go through all 45 slides. It's more so information for people who would like to see more or whatsoever. Actually, also, I would encourage you to interrupt me so that I have no concrete plan that I have to go through on the slides. And it's particularly, since I'm not quite familiar how much the audience know and what are the questions, give me some hints when I should go faster or slower, but I think is the last one. Or also, I'm happy to answer questions in the evening or whatsoever. Whenever you want to know something, address me. Okay, this I will start with a topic called Introduction to L2 Invariants. So what's behind this? What's the motivation? There's something in topology which goes on very often is you have a classical invariant, like the Euler characteristic, and then you look at this CW complex, you pass through the universal cover, try to investigate the invariant upstairs, and get a better invariant by taking the action of the fundamental group into account. And here are instances where this was very successful. For instance, you know homology with coefficients in Z from your algebraic topology course, but you may also look at homology with coefficients twisted by representations, but first time you see the fundamental group does occur. Very famous is the Euler characteristic, which you also have seen probably. If you do this game, you end up in a very sophisticated invariant called world's finest obstruction. I will not talk about it in this lecture, but see that, for instance, the abelian group that takes values has now become very advanced, namely the positive class group. If you do the same thing with Lefschetz numbers, you know them probably by the questions whether a map has a fixed point or not. It's an integer. If you do it in generalized version, you get something in the group ring, twisted. And actually this invariant does answer the question whether a map has a fixed point or not, where this invariant is not good enough. And if you do a very drastic step, take the signature of a manifold, a very classical invariant. If you do this game I've tried to play now, right now, you end up really with surgery theory in all of our facets, L theory and so on. So this was very successful. And other things where you have no precursor are torsion invariants, for instance, which occurred in Kayum's Kahn talk. So we would like to take the fundamental group acting on a universal cover into account. That's the idea. And we would like to apply a suit very classical invariant again. I would like to apply to Betti numbers, which you probably all have seen. You have a fine CW complex. You look at its homology with complex coefficients, let's say. And you look at the dimension. That's the ordinary Betti number. You have seen them probably really everybody. And now you can do it in a naive way first. It turns out that this idea is more complicated than you think. The first idea would be go to a universal cover and take the dimension. Of course, this is very naive because you have not at all taken the fundamental group into account, right? The problem is actually that this homology group is usually infinite and you will get not really an honest number. The second best choice would be to take the action of pi into account here and take a dimension which sees the dimension, sees the action. For instance, you could define the dimension of a module over Z pi just to be the dimension of the complex vector space by given by tensoring down to C, for instance. But this is not good. The reason is that the complex group ring is in general not Euclidean. That means there's no reason why this module here, even over Z pi, is fine generated again. And this dimension is not very nice. It's not additive under exact sequences. So this won't work. And the basic idea comes from Atiyah. I should say that I will not really tell this story as it was in reality. Atiyah was looking at index theory. He was looking at indices of operators and was trying to play the game there by looking at L2 indices. I would like to go to a more elementary, simpler world, but still we have some work to do. But I would like now to present what is the idea of TIA, what do we get, and we will see that we get successful and very good and powerful invariants by going through this process. But it requires some work. Okay, and now comes something into a play which you wouldn't expect when you listen to this program. We need some input from function analysis called group for Neumann algebras. And I will try to make it as gentle as possible. So through these lectures, my groups will always be discrete. I have nothing to say about Lie groups, for instance. And this is a formidable question. I do not know whether the group ring is a notion I can assume, so I put it on the slide again. So when you have a ring R and a group G, you can combine them into a new ring called the group ring RG. Elements are just formal sums, like when you have a polynomial, you have a variable and you have coefficients, here the same thing. So this RG's element in your ring, and G's are the element of the groups, but there should be only finitely many G's with the non-trivial coefficients, and you know how to add them, just component-wise, how you would add polynomials. The multiplication is actually given by a convolution product for the experts, but I like to use a formula which is very intuitive, that G times H is G times H. This is not so bad, because you should think about what I mean, and when you think about what I mean, you really have understood what the multiplication is. The point of the point is that G times H is a multiplication in the ring, and G times H here is a multiplication in the group. This is really the idea. Roughly speaking, the point is that RG, if you look at modulus over RG, it's the same as studying G representations over R. So in some sense, instead of looking at R modulus with a G action, I can mix everything together to come back to modulus over RG. Of course, there's a price to pay. This ring is very complicated. You may start with the complex numbers, which I will view as not complicated, but also the group rings over the complex numbers of groups G, and very in general, they are not Noetherian. They have a lot of zero divisors. So they have all the kind of complications you are not very happy when you encounter them. But nevertheless, that is really the ideal world to do something. Since this ring is so complicated, you're doing a typical process which you probably have seen in other instances in algebra, you complete. Right? Sometimes your ring is not big enough because by completion you have suddenly new invariants, new elements, something got more easy. And we will go in the direction of completion, but now in terms of Hilbert spaces. I will not complete the ring as you can do in algebra. I would like to make it complete in the Hilbert space sense. So let me recall a typical example of completing the group ring to something. It is the Hilbert space called L2 of G. It is simply, now I'm allowing again the sums, but now I've written formal. It's not necessarily true that only finitely many of these coefficients are zero, but now I have to have some finite condition, and the condition is simply that these elements, if you square them up with a norm, is finite. So they are square summable sums. And of course the group ring is inside this L2 of G. L2 of G is a Hilbert space, and actually C2 of G is dense. So L2 of G is really a completion. And L2 of G you may also characterize just by saying it's a Hilbert space for which the elements of the groups G form an orthonormal basis. Right. And now comes really the definition of the Feynman algebra, which we have a little bit to study and to understand. So I've written down the definition in three lines here. So this is the official definition, let's say, which you read in a textbook. You have CG, and you have a lot of many topologies on CG, and you have a weak topology, and you just complete CG in the weak topology. That is very good for functional analytic purposes, but not very much concrete. If you apply the so-called double commutative theorem, whatever it is, you get a more concrete definition, which I will use actually during this talk. Namely, the Feynman algebra I may define as operators from L2 of G to L2 of G, that was the Hilbert space I've introduced above. It should be bounded. Bound is another word for continuous. It should be linear and compatible with the G action. So let me, for later purposes, write this down here again. Okay, I learned this as well. Maybe I'll take red. So L of G we will define as all bound operators from L2 of G to itself, which are G equivariant. And why the Feynman algebra is successful actually in, not only in mathematics, this was one of the important ingredients in physics, but actually type 3 factors, not this one here, is that you have a trace. And this is the trace here. So it's a map from N of G to C, which deserves the name trace because it has some nice properties. And here's the definition, it's very easy. You take your operator F, recall this goes from here to here. And when I write on E, it means the obvious thing, because E is a unit in the group, and therefore an element in the Hilbert space as well. Let's take the sum, which has one non-trivial entry, just given this E. You can evaluate your operator on this element, or you don't. And now you take the inner product of L2 of G, and this is what it traces. Let me record it here as well. So the trace goes from the Fanorman algebra to the complex numbers, and it sends an operator here to the inner product of F of E, comma E. So it's linear, and the trace of F times G is a trace of G times F, so what you would expect from a trace is true. Let's look at one example. I will play this game very often. I will look at finite groups where nothing happens, and then I will look at the integers where you see the first time what really happens. So what happens for a finite group? Of course, then L2 of G is C of G, right? G is finite, everything is square summable. It's also not a surprise, because any finite dimensional complex vector space is complete regardless of what you're doing. So if I want to complete it, good luck, you will just get the same thing. And then also the Fanorman algebra is just a group ring. So if G is finite, nothing has really happened. And maybe it's worthwhile then to figure out what the trace is. So the trace assigns to an element like this just the coefficients of E. It's not something you may have thought a kind of sum of the coefficients, it's just the coefficients at the unit element of the group. And this formula is actually true for all groups. That means if you start with the element in the group ring, this expression is simply the coefficient of E. Very easy. But the point is that this trace, this formula, extends this formula to the full Fanorman algebra. Right? And recall, the complex group ring is included in the Fanorman algebra. Okay, but now let's look at the first example where you see that something very interesting is happening. And of course, I will look at the first infinite group. We know it's G equals to Z, but since I can handle Zn as well, I just will handle G to Zn. So what happens? Let's go through this in detail. So now I have to appeal to your knowledge about Fourier transformation. That means that if you want to compute the Hilbert space L2 of Zn, it's the same as the L2 function on the torus, right? This is just given by Fourier analysis, Fourier coefficients. Just otherwise take it at a black box. And the map is actually what you think. An element here is a sum over numbers times elements in here, and you think of them as the elements in Z just as functions from Tn to S to Z. And this is an isomorphism of Hilbert spaces. And that's the key why in the setting of commutative groups we really understand what the Fanorman algebra is and so on. And here is what it really is. You're looking now at functions on the torus which are essentially bounded. So measurable functions from Tn to the complex numbers, I will identify them if they are the same on zero sets, but they should be essentially bounded. And then the Fanorman algebra is isomorphic to this algebra, and here is the isomorphism I just said in words. You send an element f here to the operator, from there to there, given by point-wise multiplication. That's pretty easy and elementary. So in this situation, the Fanorman algebra has this specific model. And now you can imagine what the trace is. Yeah, the trace is what you would like to do. Since the functions are bounded and you're looking at a compact space, you can integrate, and this is what you're doing. So the trace is in some sense just integration of a function on L infinity of Tn. This also explains the slogan. Yes?
Yeah, what is MF?
Oh, M is this operator sending G to G times F, and this is to be meant just point-wise.
I didn't read.
Yeah. It's actually, this is the reason why sometimes people would call Fanorman algebras as non-commutative measure theory. Right, the star algebras for the experts is non-commutative functions on spaces, and Fanorman algebras is non-commutative measure theory. It really makes sense. Okay, I mean, this is a nice example. Should also warn you, in general, the phenomenal algebra, it's the best you can get. It's not very concrete. This nice modulus you have here is a coincidence. It's very nice. As soon as you leave the non-computable world, it becomes just complicated. But we will not really use the structure of the phenomenal algebra later. But now comes the main point. You can imagine, I want to remember how were the Betti numbers defined. They were the dimension of the homology. So the point will now be that I can define the dimension over the phenomenal algebra. But before I'm doing this, I also have to explain to you what will be the category I'm working in. So we have to work a little bit more further before we come to the definitions. The point is I would like to complete everything, but then I have to tell you what are my objects and what are the morphisms I will allow. And that I'm doing on this definition. Let's go through this also carefully. So there's a notion of what is called a finely generated Hilbert NG module that I want to define. And it's first of all a Hilbert space. And the Hilbert space comes with an action of your group G, which should be bilinear isometries. Of course, there are plenty so far. But now comes the decisive condition, why it becomes much more easier later. I would like to have an embedding of V into L2 of G of N, which is isometric and linear. L2 of G of N means, of course, L2 of G plus L2 of G N times. And I could ask myself whether I can find a G invariant linear subspace of L2 of G of N, which is isometrically linearly isomorphic to V. And that's the condition. Right. So later I will just work with this V sitting in L2 of G to the N, which is of course pleasant. But I would like also to say that this inclusion or this embedding is not part of the structure. I hope you understand this difference. Like when I say I have a free module, a choice of a basis is not part of the structure. There is a basis, but it's not part of the structure. The same happens here. I would like to require the existence of the embedding, but I'm not saying anything that I have chosen one. So when you have a category, you have to have two things. What are the morphisms? What are the objects? And the morphisms are just bounded G-equivalent operators. And let me emphasize, I do not demand that they're isometric. This is important. Right. So just bounded and equivariant. So the zero operator is allowed. Okay, now we can define the von Neumann dimension, which is actually due to Morey and von Neumann. It has a famous definition. Actually, it works also in an infinite dimensional context, which I would like, of course, not to present here. So how we can assign to such a module a number? So we start with this Hilbert module. And now this embedding comes into a play. I can find a projection, actually projection onto the subspace I'm looking at, which is G equivariant. Projection means P squared is P and P is P star. So that's the image of this is V. So now recall the Neumann algebra are operators from L to G of N to L to G. So what is an operator from L to G of N to L to G of N? It's a matrix, an N by N matrix over the Neumann algebra. But if I have a trace on the ring, I have a trace on the matrices, just take the sum of the diagonal entries. Therefore, I can really make sense out of this expression that the trace of the projection, it goes from there to there, is the traces of the entries you would get in this matrix. You add them up and you get a number. Actually, it turns out to be a non-negative real number. And this is our Neumann dimension. And it's actually a very well-known elementary exercise in algebra. So the keywords for experts is what is called a Hartori-Stollings rank. Maybe something says something. This is independent of the choice of the embedding. Right? I did say, tell you the embedding should not be part of the structure, so I should not use the embedding to define the invariant, or better show that the invariant is independent of the embedding, but that's the case here. By the way, a good exercise would be take G to be 1, and you will discover the dimension of a vector space. Okay, maybe we record this here as well. We can assign to a Hilbert module a nice real number. So again, finite G. If G is finite, as I told you, nothing really happens. Because such a module is exactly the same as a unitary finite-dimensional G representation. There's no difference. Recall that for finite group CG is N of G, nothing goes on. And the dimension is very boring. You take the dimension of the underlying complex vector space, and the group only enters by dividing this dimension by G. So this is really unraveling the definition. You see you have done nothing new, boring. But already with Z you see something very interesting happens. Let me go through this example again. We have our G, which was Z to the N. We have can look at any measurable subset of the torus. And then, of course, I get this whole characteristic function, which is called T of X. It's 1 on the set, it's 0 otherwise. And now I take this projection operator, just multiplying with this characteristic function, or just restricting your function to this set X. And this turns out to be an equivariant unitary projection, and its image is a Hilbert module in the sense I defined before. Right? And now you can guess what the dimension of this Hilbert module is. It's just the volume of X. Now this is really not hard to figure out. Of course, when you've seen this at first glance, it would take some time. But you see, the idea is, again, measuring the size of measurable sets. But now the news here is, that means that any real number can occur as a dimension. You see, when you're looking at the complex vector spaces, you're used to natural numbers as a dimension. Here, everything can occur. Because you can give me, let's say, take half of a square root of 2, you find the measurable set subset of S1 with this volume, and then you find a module of this shape. Yes?
Why is the dimension or the trace not just complex value?
Because the projection has the property P is P equals P star. That means the trace is invariant under complex conjugation, and therefore it's a real number. And since the projection is also a positive operator, the trace is positive. It's very convincing, but this is how it goes. A priori trace is a complex number. That's actually true.
So how do you get up to infinity? Won't you be bounded by the volume of the torus?
That was my next question. How can I get to a 1.2? I just take a V plus L2 of G. L2 of G has dimension 1. You can imagine that under direct sums, its dimension is simply additive, right? So I can realize any integer, and then I can realize any number between 0 and 1, and then I'm done. Okay, now another little technical thing. When you work in algebra, you would like to understand exact sequences. But since we are here working with Hilbert modules, I would, of course, like to have something which exact sequences, which still sees something of the Hilbert structure. And we call this weakly exact. So just a sequence is weakly exact if the kernel of P, and now you are used, is equal to the image. But I will tell you, no, I only want to have the closure of the image to be the kernel. Right? Exact means usually kernel is image. Here I'm saying kernel is the closure of the image. And I will say that the map of modules is a weak isomorphism. And now it's consequently, if it's injective, but the image is only dense, not everything. Why I'm doing this? You see, the problem is I want to stay in the world of Hilbert spaces. Therefore, I close up the things. The image of an operator has no reason to be closed. Since I'm desperate, I just close it. So, and it works out. And here's a good example that you see why this weak isomorphism is indeed weaker than an isomorphism, and you may see what's going on. Take the integers. Recall this was L2 of S1. So I want to define your map from there to there. And here's a formula. I multiply a function, u of z, with z minus 1 times u. And it's a good exercise to figure out why this is a weak isomorphism, but not an isomorphism. So why is it an isomorphism? Roughly speaking, if it were by injective, surjective, the 1 function should be in it. But that would mean that 1 over z minus 1 must come from here, and it doesn't. That is roughly speaking why something goes wrong. But because you can truncate at 1, the functions, it's still dense, the image. Okay, the good news now is it was too unfamiliar, you can forget these things now, because I will apply it formally. But the only thing we have really to take in mind now is what are the good properties of the dimension functions. These I will use. And why does this dimension function deserves the name dimension function, right? So first of all, it's indeed faithful. That means if I want to check whether a module is zero, I just have to test its dimension. Right? So if the dimension of the module is zero, the module zero itself was zero. And here's the main point, it is additivity. When you work with dimension functions, this is the main point. You have an exact sequence, you would like to have the dimension in the middle, the dimension of the outer things. But here it does suffice to have this weakly exact. If you remember, I was allowing to close the image before we have this equality. And then the dimension function doesn't see this. It thinks it's an exact sequence and has this formula you're used to. And that's the key. So it's very well behaved. And here is some, I will not go through it, some kind of continual things when you can exhaust a module by submodules, and then you can just have, it's the supreme of the dimension of the submodules is the whole thing. But it's very pleasant here. Okay, as I said, these are the three definitions. If you like to, you can restart here again. You have, just to mention, we can complete a little bit something. We get some Hilbert spaces. We can define a dimension. And the dimension may be square root of 2. But these three sentences you should really now have to in mind before I go on. Okay? Good. So what is now L2 homology and L2 Betti numbers? Remember, I promised you I will extend the classical notions to this setting where I allow actions of groups and so on. And here is the definition, the last technical definition, I think. So we start with a connected CW complex of finite type. Maybe you are happy if I say finite simplicial complex. I don't care. Could also be manifold, or closed manifold, if you like. And I told you before, I will go to the universal covering. That was our purpose, and there pi 1 of m is acting. And now you can look at the so-called cellular chain complex, or the simplicial complex, which you have certainly seen before, but which a priori is only a chain complex over the integers. And it's free there. Every simplex gives you an element. But here the point is, turns out actually to be a free C pi chain complex. And the number of basis elements upstairs corresponds to cells below. Maybe here's the main example. You take S1 with the CW structure I try to indicate here, 1-0 cell, 1-1 cell, then you get the real numbers as a universal cover. And now these cells are lifting. And the cellular chain complex of this guy here upstairs actually looks like this. And you multiply with z minus 1. You may imagine this, take a one cell here, it hits, let's say, a cell there, and it's translate, therefore you have z minus 1. The minus comes by the orientation. And this is, of course, equivariant because everything here upstairs is equivariant. And now I complete this chain complex. I do it either on the nose, by saying these are, you can take complex coefficients, complete everything, or I can do it algebraically, if you prefer that. I just take this tensor product, algebraically, where I take L2 of pi tensor z pi, this chain complex, and this turns out to be a chain complex of Hilbert spaces. Actually, it is obviously a Hilbert chain complex of Hilbert modules. And now I define the homology. And you should not be surprised by this anymore. You see, your multi is usually defined as kernel divided by the image. But you should be used to, I always say closures, because I do not know what to do else. Therefore, the L2 homology is the kernel divided by the closure of the image, which is again such a module. And now I can apply the phenomenon dimension to it and get some real numbers. So this is, in some sense, the message you should remember. You start with this W complex. Downstairs, you will look at the cellular chain complex, take its homology, take its dimension. Easy. We go upstairs, take the chain complex there, very large, but if you look at it over z pi, it becomes still a friendly, finite generated and free. Hilbert complete it. you come into the category where we can apply for number dimensions, define the homology to be kernel by the image, take its number, and that's the L2 Betti number. But it could now be a priori any real number. Okay, now I think I will not come to the technical definition anymore. I would now like to convince you that this is a good concept. So when you introduce a new invariant or so, of course, at here I can always do this, is then okay. But you should check yourself, does it have nice properties? Is it still close to the invariant you're looking at? And does it have the same success? Right? And here are the properties. I've written down the properties of L2 Betti numbers, which you probably all know. For instance, they are multiple invariants. When you have X and Y are connected to CW complexes, they are multiple equivalent, same Betti number. And very important is the Euler Poincaré formula. So I define the Euler characteristic of a CW complex to be the alternating sum, but I'm counting cells or simplices. And the basic property here is that you can compute the Euler characteristic, which does depend on the CW structure a priori, just by adding up the Betti numbers. That was the key of success for the Betti numbers to be useful. And then, for instance, you have Poincaré duality. If you have a closed manifold of dimension D, the Betti numbers in dual dimensions are the same. That's really the basic things about Betti numbers. And now you apply the L2 twiddle operator to this. Just I have turned to L2 Betti numbers. And also remember, I go upstairs and do the L2 Betti number there. But you see, the formulas are all the same if I do it back. Right? Nothing changes. Maybe it does change. No, there. But I should say the proofs are completely different. When this innocent formula here with the Euler Poincaré formula, which is something you can do in algebraic topology course, is now an index theorem. So the formality is nice, but the proofs are much harder. If you go on, for instance, Betti numbers satisfy Kühne's formula, and we all know what the zeros Betti number of a connected CW complex is, it's 1. So what happens if I go to the L2 world? The Kühne's formula is the same again, but now the theorem has the name Zucker in it, so it's again not trivial. And the Betti number becomes interesting. The zeros Betti number becomes 1 over the group order. And this is very important, because if you group it infinite, I mean it becomes zero. And this is something where it's typical for L2 Betti numbers. They are more often zero than you think, but they are not too often zero, right? If they would always be zero, then you can prove a lot of things there. But very often they vanish, and it makes calculations easier. For instance, when you apply speckled sequence arguments, we last zeros in the entries there whatsoever. So the message is zero's Betti number is trivial whenever you have an infinite fundamental group. But now comes another property which is very important, namely undefined coverings. It's multiplicative on the nose. Maybe this I'll record here as well. Now I could ask you the question whether this is true for ordinary Betti numbers. You know that S1 covers itself d times, but the zeros Betti number is always 1. So this is a new feature of we see here, which shows that something is going on here, which is very interesting. By the way, the Euler characteristic is a multiplicative. The Betti number is not, but the L2 Betti numbers are. Okay, now let's go to this game finite P and Zn. If Gp is finite, you get just this formula. You can...
I have a question.
Yeah?
On the previous.
Yeah?
So in this case, the x tilde and y tilde are the universal covers, which are the same thing.
But they're different operations of groups.
But you're thinking of it as a cover of x in one case and as a cover
right.
of y.
Right. The difference is that for x, pi 1 of x acts, and for y, pi 1 of y acts. So we have
different. Case, but with a different action.
Exactly. That's the point. Yeah. So for finite groups, nothing happens, as I have written down here. You just take the ordinary Betti number, which exists because you have a finite fundamental group, and x will is compact again, and you normalize it by the order of the group. Here I just went through S1. So we call this was a chain complex for S1. This would be the L2 chain complex, and I have computed for you before. I mentioned this is a weak isomorphism, so there is no homology, and all the LT Betti numbers are zero. So one big difference between ordinary Betti numbers and L2 Betti numbers is that the L2 Betti numbers of a sphere are all trivial. So it doesn't see S1 at all. It has to do that this operator is a weak ISO. This will have many consequences. But here's another very interesting consequence. If pi equals to z to the d, I can tell you what the Betti numbers are purely algebraically. So we're starting with the CW complex, whose fundamental group is z to the d, and then I can look at the complex grouping of zd. And this has a quotient field, right? Because it's a commutative ring. It has no zero divisors, and you can take the quotient ring as you're used to. And then the L2 Betti numbers can be computed by this expression. I'm looking at the homology of X twiddle, on which this group ring acts. I induce it up to this field, and just take the classical dimension over this field, as you're used to from algebra. And then it turns out the L2 Betti number is this expression. But why is this surprising? Because the number on the right is definitely an integer. Right? I'm talking about the dimension of a vector space over a field. And if you think about the definition I gave you in the beginning, there was no reason why this was an integer. It was a dimension of this Hilbert modules, and I told you I can give you Hilbert modules whose dimension is square root of 2. But of course, not every Hilbert module comes as the L2 cohomology of a space. That is the point here. But in some sense, this is a very fortunate case, but it's not too bad. In some sense, what you would expect in general is of this shape. I will maybe come back to this later or not. I do not know. Okay. Now let's go through some examples that you a little bit get used to how you compute with L2 Betti numbers. Let's start with finite self-coverings. So like sometimes you have spaces which cover themselves, like S1 covers itself 2 times, 3 times, d times. But now remember this formula, it is multiplicative under finite coverings. So it means automatically I have to compute nothing, they are all zero. Right? So if a space covers itself, the L2 Betti numbers are trivial. And now, for instance, you get this formula below. If you have a space of the shape S1 cross Y, it covers itself because S1 does, you get always zero. So you see that these L2 Betti numbers really tend to be zero all the time, which makes you nervous because it could be zero always. And then we also understand why they're always integers, right? So let's go on to make you nervous. This kind of idea that S1 cross a space has trivial L2 Betti numbers, then you of course ask for S1 actions. You see, you would like to study actions because actions give you some information about the symmetry of a space. So suppose now you have a connected manifold with an S1 action, and now comes a condition that if you evaluate your orbit at one point, right? We have a point in the manifold, you evaluate S there, you get an orbit there, and this map should be pi 1 injective. Right. For instance, I can't have a fixed point, otherwise it couldn't be injective. Then all the L2 Betti numbers are trivial. So this is now a rather mild condition, if you think about this here. And I also am allowing now finite isotropy. I have not said the operation is free, but it does not have to be free. So it could be that I have an operation of S1 on a manifold with isotropy, of course no fixed points. If this condition is true, there are no L2 Betti numbers. And here comes the situation where this becomes really rather drastic. That is when you look at an S1 action on a spherical manifold.
So in that theorem, there's an M and an X. Is that?
Oh, this is a misprint. Yeah,
equal
M equals X. Great. Okay. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Yeah. M is X. Sorry. So let's come to the theorem below. what is an aspherical manifold? It's a manifold whose universal covering is contractible. So we have seen many examples, like if the universal cover is Rn, it's obviously contractible. I could also say it in other words for the experts, the homotopy groups are zero. Or I could say the space is a model for the classifying space of the group. But think about the universal cover being contractible. And there are many, many examples. For instance, manifolds with non-positive sectional curvature are spherical. Many, many locally homogeneous spaces are. Three manifolds if they are not prime R, and so on. And then actually you look at any action which is non-trivial. Now you may ask me what I mean with non-trivial. Yeah, I mean not trivial. And the trivial action is doing really nothing. So if there's one point which is moved, then it's already non-trivial. So it could have a lot of fixed points, but one point should be not too lazy. But then on a spherical manifold, it turns out, first of all, there are no fixed points. Secondly, this condition is satisfied. And now I apply this theorem, so all the algebraic numbers are trivial. So I'm saying if you have any aspherical manifold and it carries some non-trivial as one action, all algebraic numbers are zero. Again, for the experts, I know only one result of this shape is saying that the ahead genus of a manifold is not so trivial if it has a non-trivial as one action. It goes in this direction. So now we got really nervous about vanishing of the Betti numbers.
Could you say that last thing again?
The ahead genus of a manifold is trivial if it has a non-trivial as one action.
Right.
This is one theorem which goes in this direction, that you have really an obstruction to an existence of an as one action at all, right?
Yes, so do you know how close, can you remove the pi 1 injective conditions?
No, definitely not.
Okay.
This is not. Yeah, I need this. The example would be just S3. You have an S1 action on S3, but because you have no fundamental group, you're looking at the ordinary Betti numbers, and they are not trivial. Yeah. I need this condition. So let's look at one example where, fortunately, we see that the numbers are non-trivial. And I will look at the surface, an orientable closed surface of genus at least one, let's say. And I will now make the computation, of course, without going through the definitions. Like when you compute singular homology, in a few cases, you really write down the singular chain complex, right? And the same is going on here as well. So what do we know? Since the genus is bigger than one, the fundamental group is infinity. Remember, we know the zero is a Betti number already. It's trivial. It was just a basic fact. Then Poincaré duality tells you in dual dimensions they are the same, so the second Betti number vanishes. In higher dimensions, you will get nothing because the singular chain complex stops there. And if you complete zero, you always get zero. So we know that there's only one chance left. It's the first Betti number. But now it's easy because of the Euler-Poincaré formula, if you remember. It does add up the alternating sum. So I know the Euler characteristic must be the first L2 Betti number up to a sign. And we know the L2 Betti number, the Euler characteristic of a surface is 2g minus 2, and since there are the surfaces of a genus bigger than 2, we really have a non-trivial L2 Betti number. So I'm allowed not to continue, otherwise I should stop here. Here's another point. You see, this L2 invariance, I will not really go so much on it, but are really also analytic invariants. You see, this is a topological audience, but as I said, we're coming from index theory here, we're coming over spectral theory operators. I would at least give you a little bit of a hint what happens on the analytic side. And here I have mentioned two theorems. The first one you may also have seen before, that you can interpret the homology of a manifold in terms of the harmonic forms. This is a classical Hodge-Cheyram theorem. It tells you if you look at those n forms on M, with the kernel of the Laplace operator, regardless of what it is, it's a God-given operator on a manifold, then you have a nice isomorphism between the Ram cohomology and the manifold, the cohomology of the manifold. And here's a very interesting expression that you can compute the Betti number in terms of heat kernels. I think I don't have the time to explain the heat kernels, but although it's very nice, maybe I can do it in private. The point is, roughly speaking, the operator gives you You can apply functional calculus to it, then it has a kernel. You can evaluate the kernel at the diagonal, take the traces and integrate this. And now comes a point. You look at it for large times. So the L2 Betti numbers has to do with the, let's say, the heat for large times, whereas index theory, where you look at t equals zero, is local time. It has to do with how heat evolves. And you can imagine that if you look at large time behavior, you will see much more of the geometry. Suppose you have a manifold and you start putting some heat on it. If you only wait very short time, the distribution will think that you are on a disk. But if you wait and wait and wait, then it will go around the holes and has time to explore the manifold and it sees the large scale geometry. That's the reason why this formula is really very interesting. And now you may think about what I'm doing. I'm clicking and now you have the L2 versions of this. And again, I will warn you, the proofs are not so easy. But the analogy should be clear. Let's do it on the first slide. So the homology is the formula there. So I put an L2 where I need it, right? So we have harmonic forms, but this should be L2 square integral. This is this condition. We have the Laplace operator upstairs. So the same formula holds. That's the result of dot Duke. And also the heat kernel has still the same expression, but now you go to universal cover, but you have to look at the fundamental domain of your action. It would correspond here, roughly speaking, to take a subset of R, which up to measure zero is really homeomorphic to the S1. And then you get still the same formula. You can imagine that also these invariants measure some large scale behavior.
So
yes?
This is maybe a stupid question. So when you were defining the L2 Betti numbers in the first place, the L2 conditions sort of showed up within the group ring.
Yes.
But when, you know, if I just saw a formula that looks like that, that looks like integration on the manifold.
Yes.
So did those wind up coinciding somehow?
Then I would have to go through the proof, and I could see very nicely see why the left side has these terms. I want to integrate something in this L2 integral, and the other the chains. Yes, absolutely.
On the bottom formula, is there a sum over the group somewhere in there, in the trace of the heat?
No. The group. Actually, we'll come to this later. The group is hidden only here, and this will be very important.
Okay.
Actually, I can say it in the words. Suppose you have two hyperbolic manifolds. There's the same universal cover, this here harmonics, and I have to do only one calculation for this for the hyperbolic space, for the Gaussian trace, and then I have to integrate, and you only see some volume occurring up, because this is what the fundamental domain gives you. I will come to this later. So here's the formula for hyperbolic manifolds. So actually, what I said, how do you compute it for an arbitrary L2 Betti number? You only have to compute when you want to get zero whether this space is trivial. But this is now a question about the hyperbolic space. You have forgotten your manifold, and this is you have to solve certain equations. And so the hyperbolic space is so symmetric, so that the spectrum of the Laplacian is very easy to figure out. And then you get to come to this formula that all L2 Betti numbers are zero except in one dimension in the middle. So if the hyperbolic manifold is of odd dimension, they are all zero. If the hyperbolic manifold is, for instance, four-dimensional, we have just one non-negative Betti number, it sits in the middle dimension. This is an argument with hyperbolic space, but now what is the conclusion? Now we start with a hyperbolic manifold of dimension n, d, and now suppose that the dimension is 2m. And now I'm getting information about the order characteristic. I'm telling you the order characteristic is either positive or negative, depending on whether m is odd or even. This is actually a consequence of the open Hopf conjecture. The Hopf conjecture tells you in general, if you have a manifold of negative sectional curvature, then the order characteristic satisfies this parity. But I want to emphasize, this statement doesn't involve L2 Betti numbers. Right? It makes sense. This statement also doesn't involve L2 Betti numbers. I'm just claiming if you have a hyperbolic manifold, there can't be any S1 action. The proofs use L2 Betti numbers. Namely, remember the calculation of the L2 Betti numbers of the hyperbolic manifold, there was only one that was non-trivial. So we can play the game with the surface again. We compute the oil characteristic times minus 1m to be exactly the m's L2 Betti number, which I know is non-positive, therefore it is positive. So this equation, where I have no idea what it is actually a consequence of the deeper relation you see here, plus the proof that this number is positive. So you see that a statement which doesn't involve L2 Betti numbers on the first glance actually has a nice proof with L2 Betti numbers. And also with the S1 action, let me give you the proof in dimension, where the dimension is even. Then we would know that the m's Betti number is positive, but the hyperbolic space is contractible, so any hyperbolic manifold is a spherical. But I proved before that an spherical manifold, which has a non-trivial S1 action, has vanishing L2 Betti numbers, contradiction, so there can't be at all an S1 action. A similar argument works in other dimensions, then you have to invoke L2 torsion, but I think it will just be beyond the scope of this talk. But the point of this slice here is, that it happens very often, there are problems in geometry, topology, or group theory, which on the first glance didn't involve L2 Betti numbers, but the use of L2 Betti numbers was a key to a proof. Here I just would like to state a result without going through the proofs, although it really uses all things we know about three manifolds. But I would like to tell you, and this is a rather surprise, if you give me three manifolds, we really can compute all L2 Betti numbers. And the formula is not as complicated as you think, right? Some R, some fundamental groups, number of components. Try to compute the homology of a three manifold, the ordinary one. There is no formula for this. It can be anything. But here we get very nice formulas. And one point I want to point out, these numbers are all rational numbers. And if the fundamental group is torsion-free, they're all integers. Remember that I mentioned before that if the fundamental group is Zn, we know that all the L2 Betti numbers must be integers, and this computation confirms that. The other computations as well, hyperbolic manifolds, it was the Euler characteristic, for surfaces I did it by hand, it was 2g minus 2. So you see something seems to go on, yet not all possible values are, all the values are possible. Maybe I will skip this, this is about mapping torus. And I will also skip the proof. Although this is very elementary, it's a really nice argument, but I will not do this. I would now like to come to something which is one of the big open conjectures in this area, and which actually will enter again in my third talk. And therefore, I should spend some time on this. So a TCU conjecture in the most elementary fashion is the following. You're looking at a torsion-free finite presented group, G, and we say that it satisfies the Artier conjecture. Is this what I expected before, that if you have any closed Riemannian manifold with this fundamental group, all L2 Betti numbers are integers. Remember, this is a really surprising conjecture if you think about the definition of the L2 Betti numbers as a limb over T goes to infinity of an integral F over the trace of the heat kernel. Why the heck should this be an integer? But it's completely surprising. And it's pretty amazing that Artier at least raises as a question when he was introducing this image because no computations were available. So I hope you understand this conjecture. I think it should not be so hard, right? You looking at a group G, I fix this. It's finally presented. Let's say whenever I have a manifold with this fundamental group and a computer L2 Betti numbers, there are integers. And as I said before, all computations I've presented, or just present very quickly, support this conjecture at least. It's also very nice if you have a conjecture without counterexamples. So now, how do we want to address this? And here, for me, a very exciting mix of ring theory, function analysis, and K-theory comes in. And here's what I will call the fundamental square, which I also record here, which we will see later again. So we start with the integral group ring. I think we know what this is. And you're also probably, maybe not happy, but you will have seen the Von Neumann algebra. And now I'm doing something which is, let's say, for the experts, I will go to the algebra of affiliated operators, to the von Neumann algebras. For the experts, they are defined as follows. I'm looking at densely defined operators on L2 of G, whose spectral projections all belong to the von Neumann algebra. And then the marvelous thing happens, I still can compose them. It's not all clear. Right? If you have two operators which are only densely defined, why can I compose them? Here you can. It has to do with the von Neumann dimension. This is what a functional analysis would say. An algebraist would say it's an all localization. And let me also a little bit brief here. You know, if you have a ring which is commutative and has no zero devices, you can pass through the quotient field that you have seen. And sometimes you can still make a kind of process of this shape where your ring is non-commutative, but you need a third called Euler condition, whatever it is, and then you write on formal refractions. And it really turns out that this algebra is just this algebraic process applied to the von Neumann algebras with respect to all non-zero devices here. So you take all elements in here which are non-zero devices and you invert them formally and you get this algebra. So it's a very nice interplay between a purely algebraic process or a very functional neural process. Of course, you can imagine it's always very fruitful when you have both sides. So this is, of course, much the less clear thing, but the harder part maybe is D of G. Let me write sort of a slide. So I explain U of G. What is D of G? It's an algebraic construction. Namely, you're looking at those subrings of U of G, which contain this. And the basic property is the following. Suppose you have an element in here, which is invertible there. Then it's already invertible here. Right? So when you run a test, an element is a unit, you only have to do it there. And take the smallest ring with this property. This is what is called the division closure of this and that. For ring theorists, it's a very natural condition. When I encountered the first style, I found it pretty weird, but you can really do something with it. So what you really have to have in mind, there is some fundamental square group ring for normal algebras. You invert something, and then you get a ring in between here. OK, what happens if G is finite? You know, this game we want to play, this happens. Now, this is, of course, quite nice. CG is CG. The von Neumann algebra is a complex group ring. With densely defined operators, don't worry. Nothing happens there. And this D of G is just Q of G, if you think about it. So that looks familiar. It's also nice to say what happens if G is the integers. So I try to explain why you think of the von Neumann algebra of the bounded functions. And this U of G is just all measurable functions on this one. I forget the bounded. And this is quite nice. The D of G is indeed the quotient field you get here. Just take, instead of Z of Z, the complex, the rational group ring, and take its quotient field. So you see that this D of G tries to generalize things which we know for commutative groups very well. This is the idea of this square. For the experts, if G is elementary amenable, this G of G is indeed again an Euler localization. But in general, it's not, because this Euler localization doesn't apply to groups which are non-elementary amenable. So in some sense, this is also generalizes things which we know and understand for so-called elementary amenable groups. If you don't know what elementary amenable is, for instance, solvable groups are typical. Free groups are never elementary amenable. So maybe I can skip this here. But now I can reformulate the Artier conjecture in a very interesting fashion. Namely, I could say that I have a torsion-free group, and it satisfies the Artier conjecture exactly if this is this Q field. Right. This you have to now to think about it for a second. The first definition was all algebraic beta numbers are integers. And now I certainly have something where I'm saying some weird ring is a skew field.
What are you calling a skew field?
A field which is not commutative. So a ring which is not commutative, but you have inverses, except for the zero. Yeah. The quaternions, that would be the typical thing. And here's another formulation, how this translates to our questions about dimensions. Of course, there's some way to go. So I can reformulate this in the following fashion. I start with any matrix over the integral group ring. This is important. It's not a matrix over the Fanorman algebra. It comes from the integral group ring. Could be the differential of a chain complex. Then I can look at the operator from ng of m to ng of n, which is just given by right multiplication with A. It's a matrix. You can multiply. And I'm looking at this dimension. And then the question is, this is an integer exactly, is the idea conjecture. And what is the integer? The integer is the same thing if you would apply it to D of G and take the dimension of this kernel as over this Q field. This is really the why this is fundamentally square. You start with a matrix here, now you have two choices. You go this way or you go that way. The role of this algebra is that it contains both of them. Otherwise you couldn't compare. Going from there to there gives you the statement some algebraic number is an integer. And I can push it here as well. From the dimension function here extends this space as well. Or I go from there to there, but then I can take a dimension function already here because it's this Q field. But since the dimension of this Q field is an integer, you should not be surprised that you get an integer for the Betti numbers. And the hard part is it goes also the other way around. But that really involves ring theory. Okay, finally, why is the idea conjecture interesting for people in algebra? It has, for instance, the following consequence that the so-called Kaplansky conjecture is true. So you start with a torsion-free group, you start with a field of characteristic zero, and you ask your question whether the group ring has no non-trivial zero divisors. A question about algebra. You would never dream about for normal algebras entering here. But the point is, you can reduce this F actually to the complex numbers. There's some elementary algebra. If I can prove the conjecture for F equals the complex numbers, I have it for all F. But now, this here tells me that F of G or C of G is containing this Q field. But then they can't have any zero divisors. Right? Something with this Q field is the field without zero divisors, because otherwise you would have no inverses. So the idea of proving this conjecture has been just to show that this ring is Q-field. And there are many instances where the Kaplansky conjecture was not known before, but we know the Artier conjecture, so we really got new information about the Kaplansky conjecture from this Artier conjecture. I would want to emphasize a point here. It would never occur to you when you want to take such a problem to use spectral analysis of a normal algebra. But that's the key to success very often. I should also say there are versions of the Artier conjectures where you replace torsion-free by bound on the orders, but it turns out there are manifolds whose universal covers have an algebraic number which is actually irrational. So in the beginning, people always thought that the algebraic number should always be rational. This was Artier's questions, but recently, 2 or 3 years ago, one could figure out that if you drop torsion-free and you take any closed Riemannian manifold, you may have any number occurring, essentially. It was pretty surprising because when you look at orbifolds and algebraic numbers, generalized orbifold invariants, you would really think it should be a rational number. Okay, here's just to end, just the status of this conjecture. So there are two things proven by Linnell, the first one, Beschick, the last one. So Linnell showed it for a certain class which is closed under extensions by so-called elementary manifold groups and by directed unions, and every torsion-free group which belongs to this class satisfies the conjecture. And Thomas showed it for what is called residually torsion-free elementary manifold groups. The message I would like to send you here is, it will become interesting in the third talk, if you have the fundamental group of a three-manifold, it always satisfies the Artier conjecture. That is the key why I will later, the third talk, can use the Artier conjecture without mentioning it, because due to Linnell's result and, of course, other input from manifold theory, we know the Artier conjecture for those fundamental groups. And here's the strategy how to prove the conjecture. I will finish. Now you see, algebraic K-theory entering, right? And I will talk next time about the Fell-Jones conjecture. This is about algebraic K-theory, but my motivation came from that here conjecture originally. So if you can prove these three steps, then you are done. So the certain maps between projective class groups are surjective, and D of G is same as simple. And I always thought this is a very hard one, and this one are easier. Meanwhile, we have proved this for many, many classes of groups. So I came back to this one. I must admit they are not so easy as I thought. Right? So we really thought that, oh, we have the Fell-Jones conjecture for many, many groups here. Then we should continue, but no, it seems to be a long way still. But this is the best program to prove that here conjecture, which I know. Thanks.